Hello, everyone, and happy Pride Month. I'm recording this message at the end of a week that included 9 convocation ceremonies, and I must say it was wonderful to see so many faculty members in attendance, and especially to meet some of you for the very first time. As usual, I wanted to share a few updates with you, and so I have 3 this month, starting with the university policy on examinations, then about the transition to Brightspace, and finally some notes about accessibility. First, let's talk about examinations. This is something we've been working on certainly since I arrived at Brock about 10 months ago, but it's also very much in line with the short-term plan priority of the Undergraduate Student Affairs Committee, or USAC. So over the past several months, the Office of the Registrar, the Center for Pedagogical Innovation, and I conducted a thorough review of the language in the relevant section of the faculty handbook, which, in case you're wondering, is section 3A9. We began this process in December of last year. We consulted with USAC, of course, as well as the members of the Teaching and Learning Policy Committee. In doing so, we identified some major areas of policy gaps. This includes things like the complete absence at that point of guidance concerning online examinations or take-home examinations. And of course, that's something we learned a lot about over the pandemic, as you know. But we also achieved consensus around other policy goals, including alleviating bureaucratic workload where possible, and of course, empowering faculty where possible as well. We then drafted these revisions, presented them to members of the Undergraduate Student Affairs Committee, Teaching and Learning Policy Committee, and even to Rural Council, where in some sections that was important. And we did that between April and May of this year. And so I'm delighted to report that on May 17th, the members of the Undergraduate Student Affairs Committee recommended these revisions to Senate, and Senate formally approved and adopted these on May 31st. You will soon see these revisions online in the faculty handbook, but I wanted to give you a preview. This includes, for example, new guidance for conducting online examinations, take-home examinations, but also scheduling out-of-class midterm examinations through the Office of the Registrar. When I talked about empowering instructors, one good example of this is the existing language, or the previous language, I should say, talked about how department chairs had to ensure that examinations in the context of multi-section courses were comparable. But of course, we certainly believe that we can entrust individual instructors to make sure that their assessments align with the course learning outcomes. So that helps also alleviate the burden on department chairs, for example. Additional changes include things like the section around religious obligations and academic accommodations, expanding that a bit so that instead of just talking about religious obligations, we now also encompass First Nations, Métis, or Inuit cultural observations or obligations as well. So I encourage you to review these revisions ahead of the fall semester, but as I said, you should see them online soon. Maybe in the same breath, I'll also note that the Teaching and Learning Policy Committee has actually placed the evaluation policy and the review of that policy on their plan for the next academic year. And so this has to do with all of the assessments that are not examinations. I'm sharing this with you because if there are areas in that policy that have troubled or maybe constrained you, or perhaps that you have ideas for how to improve, I would certainly love to hear from you, whether by email or even through the web form that is embedded on my webpage. Second update, as I said, has to do with our transition to Brightspace, which is, of course, coming to its final phase. Specifically, on June 30th, the web address that you've been using these past several years to access Sakai, lms.brocku.ca, that will begin to point to Brightspace. And so moving forward, you will have to use sakai.brocku.ca to access that old system. I'll note, of course, that about 3/4 of all courses this spring are making use of Brightspace. And of course, the change to this primary URL is an important step in the transition to our new and permanent learning management system. Finally, I'd like to share with you a few updates about efforts to better support accessibility on campus. Now, as you may know, our new academic plan aims to create a campus culture that is welcoming, that is safe, that is inclusive, and that adopts an intersectional approach to advancing social justice. This specifically includes a pledge to combat ableism and anti-disability by moving to more inclusive and universal design in learning. Among recent developments in this space includes a discussion that was held last month at the Senate Teaching and Learning Policy Committee about accessibility in teaching and learning. And one of the key takeaways or highlights from that discussion was the need to move away from high-stakes assessment practices to more inclusive approaches that, for example, embrace principles of universal design. On a different track, is the work of the Learning Spaces Modernization and Planning Advisory Group that is prioritizing accessibility in their work, including in the context of a full audit of learning spaces across campus that is scheduled for this summer. But the development that I'm most excited to share with you in this update is a collaboration between the Center for Pedagogical Innovation and our colleagues in Student Accessibility Services, where we've worked together to develop a position, and now we're hiring this position, which is a Senior Educational Developer, Accessibility and Inclusion. This individual will be an important new resource for faculty, for part-time instructors, for teaching assistants, when it comes to designing learning environments that are inclusive and accessible. This is really critical work because it cuts to the core of questions around equitable access to higher education. And yet it does require expertise and guidance, clearly. And this is expertise that we want to make sure that you as faculty have access to. So those are my three updates for you this month. As always, please do not hesitate to reach out if I can be of service, or indeed if you've identified additional ways in which the university can better support your teaching and learning practice. For now, thank you very much for listening. Be well.